Welcome to Living Manna, a radio ministry of Manna Mission Church, Teshinungwa, Ghana. Your host, Reverend Dr. Seth Ablo, in a moment will bring you a life-transforming, fresh manna from the Word of God that you can depend on. The scripture says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. For the bread of God is he who comes from heaven and gives life to the world. Matthew 4:4, John 6:33. Living Manna is purposely programmed for you to give you scriptures that you can depend on under any circumstance in life. And now, listen to the music of the Manna Mission Choir before Reverend Dr. Ablo comes to speak to you.
You have tuned in to listen to Living Manna. Before we go on today's broadcast, I want to tell you a little bit about Manna Mission. Manna Mission is a ministry that effectively combines Christ-centered, compassionate medical care, effective evangelism, and community development in a strategic way. You know, three goals are what we are pursuing at Manna Mission. One is to provide Christ-centered, compassionate medical care through our hospital work and our clinic and medical mission. I mean, I've been speaking here many times and announcing tremendous breakthrough opportunities for people. And this year, we have a lot of things for eye care, for female problem, for general care. And if you're living around the Teshinungwa area, just call in and you will benefit. We're delighted to serve you and provide that care. We also have strategic community development program, and basically we are pursuing education from the lowest level, Manna Mission Academy. Our goal is change your mind and change your world. Bible says Jesus grew in wisdom and in power and was in favor with God and man. We believe that by changing the mind, the academic ability of children, tomorrow they will live in a better world. And of course, evangelism, the preaching of the gospel through our church and branches and intra-church program called National Schools of Ministry. We have a whole package for you to bless you. Welcome to Living Manna. I'm so glad you have tuned in. We are continuing our series, Christ Redeemed Us from the Curse of the Law. We've been dealing with blessings and curses, and we've been reading from Galatians chapter 3 verse 13 to 14. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. He redeemed us in order that the blessings given to Abraham might come to us through Jesus Christ, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. I was speaking last week and saying there are a few things we want to explain in this verse. Christ redeemed us means he bought us from a position. We were slaves to sin, about to be destroyed, and he bought us through the shed blood, and I will explain that. Then there's a word curse. We explained curse and blessing last week, but for review, a blessing or benediction is supernaturally imparted through the words we speak. Words are very powerful. And sometimes when we are in good mood, we speak blessing. In the Bible, one day in Genesis 27, Isaac blessed his son Jacob after he had eaten a good meal that he liked, you know, prepared. He thought it was prepared by Jacob, but it was really prepared by Rebecca. But in that good mood, Isaac said, so he went and Isaac said to his son, come, let me kiss you. So he went and kissed him. When Isaac caught the smell of his clothes, he blessed him and said, ah, the smell of my son is like the smell of a field that the Lord has blessed. May God give you of heaven's dew and of earth's richness, an abundance of grain and new wine. May nations serve you and peoples bow down to you. Be Lord over your brothers, and may the sons of your mother bow down to you. May those who curse you be cursed, and those who bless you be blessed. I love this blessing. You know why? It says, may God give you heaven's dew. You know, I lived in a village, and every time we planted things, if it doesn't rain and the dew from the Aburi Mountains fall on our tomatoes, our crop just looks so good. It's called the morning dew. In your life, rains, blessing, things coming at the right time is also heaven's dew. And then the richness of the earth, God is wishing that not only from above, but from below, you will be blessed. Earth richness, an abundance of grain. I know what it's like when we have a lot of corn and the barns are filled and our bankus looking bigger and bigger, and so our kenke. You know, it's just blessing. You know, last few weeks, we lost an old lady from the village, a friend of mine, Abram Lai's mother, died. And when I went to the funeral, I just remember when we were little boys and the corn grew up and the grains were filling the barns, this woman will make huge, soft kinky, which my father really liked. And you could tell that God has blessed the village women. This is the blessing that was spoken. May nations serve you and people bow down to you. No, may people honor you. Yes, sir. You're a big shot. All those words are part of a blessing. Hey, you wish somebody will bless you today, don't you? There are also curses that we looked at last week, that a curse means to speak evil over somebody, usually in an anger. They've disobeyed you. They've stolen your things. I remember at the beach at Teshing, when the boys stole the fishes from the women carrying these huge loads of fishes, they would just turn around and curse them in the name of rivers all the way from Teshi to Adan. And do you know that some of them die? So a curse, if it has a cause, it will work. There are many instances that curses were also spoken in the Bible. You know, sadly, one of them was spoken over a servant of God. You heard me correct. One day, a man called Elisha, he healed a leprous man called Naaman. But for some reason or the other, he didn't take an offering. He didn't want the man to think that he had paid for the healing, because the healing was actually a work of grace. God did it by grace, not by the money. So this prophet didn't want to take the money. Oh, I'm not saying it should be like today. Oh, people say you let that big offering go. So when the man left, the servant, that means the junior pastor, thought, I need that money so bad. My church hasn't paid me big money and this rich man is going free. So he chased him up. And he said to them, and he said to Naaman, Naaman, my master just got visitors. He said, my master was too easy on Naaman. I'll run after him and get something from him. So Gehazi hurried after Naaman. When Naaman saw him running toward him, he got down from the chariot to meet him. Is everything all right? He asked. Everything is all right, Gehazi answered. My master sent me to say, two young men from the company of the prophets have just come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give them a talent of silver and two sets of clothing. By all means, take two talents, said Naaman. He had Gehazi to accept them, and then tied up the talents and the silver in two bags. Then Gehazi, a pastor in training, came to the hill, took the things from the servants, and put them away in the house. He sent the men away, and they left. Then he went in and stood before his master, the pastor, Elisha. But Elisha, the Holy Spirit, told him, the man, the young boy in front of you, has done evil. So Elisha said, where have you been, Gehazi? Elisha asked, your servant didn't go anywhere. That's another lie. Gehazi answered, but Elisha said, was not my spirit with you? It means God's spirit was with you. Oh, I'll learn something from this. That means I'm a preacher. If I go somewhere and I'm taking bribe, God's spirit is with me. I am a powerful preacher. But if I took one of my girls in my office to a quiet hotel and having sex with her, God's spirit is seeing me. Oh, I'm a pastor. I just blessed the offering. Then I took it to my office and I just helped myself with 5 million CDs from that offering. God's spirit is with me. Every time I read this, I fear. Elisha asked, it said, was not my spirit with you when the man got down from his chariot to meet you? Is this the time to take money or to accept clothes, olive groves, vineyard, flocks, heads of men servants and maid servants? Naaman's leprosy will cling to you and to your descendants forever. Can you imagine all the silver, the talents, the clothes that they brought? A leprous skin cannot use them. Sin will stink in your mouth like hot coffee. You can't swallow it. Oh, I think you should just run away from it and not participate. If you have any problem, maybe I'm speaking and I'm directing something to you, I beg of you, I didn't want to accuse you. God didn't come to condemn us, but I'm bringing this up so you will repent and seek the face of the Lord. And the Bible says Christ came to redeem us from the curse of the law. Last week, I told you certain things that bring blessing, in the same way, certain things that bring curses. But stealing can bring curses. Lying can bring curses. Disobedience to God's word can bring curses. Worshipping of idols can bring curses. Sexually immoral act can bring curses. You know, there's a man in the Bible called Jacob. He cursed his son because the son had gone in to have sexual affair with some of the women who were married to his father. Now, Jesus came to redeem us from sin. I want to tell you, no matter what the sins be, Christ came, John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world should be saved. Last week we learned about a woman that was about to be killed, and Jesus saved her life. Today, I'll tell you about another woman. She was a beautiful woman. That's my version. And a rich woman in John chapter 4, living in a town called Samaria. Maybe because of her beauty or her marriage, men easily came to her. You know, one time I saw a woman who said, Seth, when I was in the world, I was very bad. If I met your husband, you don't have a husband anymore. It just doesn't take me but a minute to get a man. And now I'm a believer. For the past 15 years, no man has said, I love you. I just love. This woman had no problem with women or with men like that. She had all the men. And one day she was going to fetch water. She was religious. She went to church. She knew the Bible of her time. She attended Bible rituals and ceremony like Christmas. For our days, Then she met Jesus alone and they got into a conversation. And Jesus asked this woman, give me a drink. And the woman started arguing, you are a Jew. How come you are asking me water? I'm a Samaritan. But that's not what I want to talk about. I want to talk about this part of the story that the woman said to Jesus, sir, Jesus first said to the woman, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. He told her, go call your husband and come back. I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true. Sir, the woman said, I can see that you are a prophet. Our fathers worship on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus declared, believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship him in spirit and in truth. Why am I reading all this to you? Look at the stubbornness of sin. First, the woman with five husbands, right now staying in a home with a man, not her husband, maybe her own friend's husband. When that was revealed to her, you would think she would say, Lord, forgive me. But she had the endurance and the boldness to say something else. She is different from the woman that we heard last week from. When they revealed her sin, she just stood there speechless and said nothing. But I know people are taking other people's husband, and they will even go on radio to stand and justify why they look pretty, why the wives look ugly, and why they should be in the car and in the nice house and not the wife. God have mercy. This woman said, sir, the woman, I consider you are a prophet. Our fathers worship on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Can you imagine? After you've been caught in sin, you're still saying you go to the correct church. My friend, it's not a church which will save you. So Jesus said, believe me, woman, a time is coming when neither in your church, where the temple is so nice, or in my church, where it's so nice, neither where there's good singers, nice robe choir, shining pew, terrazzo floor, or tile floor, or decorations on the wall. Listen to me. I'm not saying those things are not nice. I know better. When Solomon built the temple, then big guys came to church. When Solomon was not having, when David was worshiping in the tabernacle, the Bible never said a queen of Sheba came to church. But when Solomon built a nice temple, oh, the rich like to enter in their nice cars and have the wedding of their children done in the nice auditorium. So I know what good churches can be. But Jesus is saying, woman, that is not the issue. The time is coming and an outcome when the true worshippers of the Father shall worship him in spirit and truth. God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. Then the woman now said, I know that the Messiah called Christ is coming. He will purify us and clean us and do things like what you are saying. Then Jesus said, I who speak to you, I am he. That moment, the woman changed. An adulterous woman, supposed to be stoned, met Jesus. Took a little while, but finally repented of her sin. Was able to let that man go. Hear me, woman. I know there are bad songs in the world. I know a woman singing that if living with you is wrong, I don't want to be right. You know what she's saying? She's staying with somebody's husband and she is singing. If going to bed with you is wrong, I don't want to be right. I want to do the wrong thing. People are so stubborn in their sexual sin. But thank God, Jesus, by speaking, this woman heard and repented and went and called the crowd, come and see a man that told me all the things that I've ever did. Different man. Come and see a man who didn't take advantage of me when he was counseling me and didn't ask me, show me what you do with those people who counsel you. God redeemed that woman. She didn't die. Why? She met Jesus. In the same way, the scripture is saying, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. How? We have all sinned, but Christ came into this world and he died on an old rugged cross. Yes, Christ died. I know some people, they have problem with that. But Isaiah says, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up, that's Jesus, before him like a tender shoot. And like a root out of the dry ground, he had no beauty. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces. Surely, he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him smitten by God, stricken of him, and he was afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. Jesus was telling the woman, you don't have to be dry and be acting like you have water. Marrying 5 husbands hasn't quenched your thirst. You know, one day a young woman in Florida died, homicide in Florida on a hot summer. When the police were doing their investigation, they found her diary. She was single. She was beautiful. She was top executive. She was living in a good side of town, gated community, nice car. She was a young urban professional. But she wrote in her diary, after a big dinner with men, where are the men that don't just want my body, but want a relationship? Where are the men that don't just want to drink beer with me, but want a relationship, a man and a wife? Where are the men that don't want to take advantage of me sexually, but want to embrace my baby? I want to meet one in my life before I die. Unfortunately, she didn't meet one. She died. God didn't want this woman to die, so they brought Jesus to meet this woman at the well so that this woman will have life and have it abundantly. This Easter time, we will read many things about the death of Jesus. But the main reason he was wounded for our transgression. Look at how he died. Matthew recorded from the 6th hour how he died. Mark also recorded how he died. How
At the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried and gave up the ghost. Why did he die? What is the meaning of his death? This is what the Bible says. He saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. By you meeting Jesus like the woman I described, you will not meet death. You will have life and have it more abundantly. What then shall we say? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. So today, if you really want to benefit from the death of Jesus, maybe pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I'm tired of making excuses for my mistakes. I acknowledge my own faults and mistakes, and I ask you to forgive me. I ask you to help my heart to change, that I will do opposite what I used to do. I confess them to you, Jesus. Now may your Son redeem me from the consequences of that sin. You said if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins like you forgave this woman. Now you came that I will have life and have it more abundantly. By your death this Easter, remind me that as you were crucified, my old man was crucified. As you died, my old nature died. As you victoriously and miraculously rose from the grave, may I also exhibit new creation life, that I can truly say, the sins I used to do, I do them no more. God be merciful. Be gracious to the young woman praying this prayer. And be gracious to the young man praying this prayer. Grant us a miracle this Easter. Let there be many miracles like this woman coming back from the pool and saying, I have met Jesus, and a new life for me has begun. I will never be the same. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord prosper you. May the dew fall upon you if you have prayed that prayer. May richness of the ground be your portion. May your barns be filled with plenty. If you've said that prayer, write to me, Mana Mission Box TN1032, or call 716-055. I have a special booklet I want to give you. I love you, and God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You have just heard from Reverend Dr. Seth Ablo of Mana Mission Church, First Junction Road, Teshinungwa Estates, Triblo, Last Bus Stop, Teshi. It is our prayer that you would join us in worship at Mana. Our Sunday program is as follows. 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. English and Tree Worship Service. 9:30 to 10:30 a.m. Combined Sunday School for All Ages. 10:30 a.m. to 12:45 p.m. English and Ga Worship Service. Mana Mission Church is a New Testament model church where the Word of God is demonstrably ministered through the enabling power of the Holy Spirit. For more information on how to receive ministry from Dr. Ablo, please write to Living Manor, Mana Mission, Box 1032, Teshinungwa Estates, or call us at 712-892. Accra, Ghana. Telephone 712-892. Please join us same time next week for Living Manna and invite your friends to listen. Until then, remember that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. May God richly bless you, and you know He will. In Jesus' name, amen.